गुड इवनिंग सर।
हाय, गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर नीलिमा। फाइनली वी आर हियर टुगेदर।
वेलकम टू एवरीवन फॉर दिस वंडरफुल सेशन ऑन एंड्रोपॉज, द फिजिकल, साइकोलॉजिकल, सेक्सुअल एंड सोशल वेलबींग, पर्टिकुलरली इन मेंस हेल्थ। आई'd लाइक टू वेलकम डॉक्टर एन के खेतरपाल, हु इज ए कंसल्टेंट फिजिशियन, एमडी फिजिशियन फ्रॉम हिसार इन हरियाणा। He is also a consultant psychiatrist and a consultant in sexual medicine. He has dealt with men and women's problems over the last 40 years. And one of his interests is also in de-addiction from drug addiction, people who are depressed, suicidal, and have drug addiction. So welcome to this session. And thank you so much for agreeing to come and chat with us about men's health in particular.
Thank you very much. In fact, I am grateful to you that you collaborated with me and invited me for this. I have seen a long list of eminent speakers, big people that have come on your show and talked to you. And if I have come in that league, I am grateful indeed.
That no, is, sir, you are very special.
Respect I to think, me and I feel obliged and privileged.
I think from the moment we started talking, I just knew that you would be the best kind of person to talk to, because it's just so easy to talk to you, and you're so warm and kind-hearted, and it just comes across in your voice when I spoke on the phone with you. And I thought you just have to come and talk to people, because
this
your voice
internet has
kind of
brought
voice
people
that people
together
like to listen.
Like earlier we could never interact with our colleagues across the globe.
Yes.
And now with WhatsApp, Facebook and everything, in being a part of one sexual academic group,
yes,
so we could interact with each other, and I'm here. Whatever,
yes,
I can, you know, tell your audience and your people, it will be a pleasure sharing.
I'm sure it's going to be a treat, because Dr. Khetarpal is not just a physician, not just a doctor. He is an artist, he's an a musician, and he's an avid traveler. If it hadn't been for COVID, he would have been traveling all over the world. And he's also an adventurist. And I'm going to leave it for him to tell you what his adventures have happened. And I'll just show you this wonderful portrait thing that he did of me. As soon as he saw the picture, that is what he's done. And he did another one. And this one, this is the one I love the best. So thank you so much, sir. That's really wonderful.
No, it is
beautiful.
Not me. It is just an app. But I am a sketch artist, and I have sketches of all the girls in my batchmate and all the my teachers when I would not take notes and rather make sketches of them in the class.
Oh, that's nice. Thank you. But it still takes an artistic eye. It doesn't matter if the app works. You know, after all, it's it's not the tools. It's who uses the tools that matters also.
Thank you very much for a very kind and nice introduction. And I started my journey from a medical college in Rohtak way back in 1969 batch. And then I did my MD medicine, because in those days, psychiatry was not the subject,
right,
for post-graduation in that institute. It was only in Bangalore or somewhere, and very less. And I was drawn to hypnotism during my school days, medical school days. And I demonstrated hypnotism in a science society when I was a fourth year medical student.
Wow.
And then even made my professor operate hernia on a boy of 14-year-old without anesthesia under hypnosis.
Wow. That's amazing.
And then my professors used to give me some psychosomatic problems for me to solve them under hypnosis.
Yes.
But since hypnosis takes a lot of time, so practically I have used it only occasionally or whenever it was necessary, but the principles I have used in my practice. And I did MD medicine, then did job in medical college, and got settled in Hisar way back in 1981. Since then, I have been drawn to, because this belt, this area, Haryana agriculture area, people consume poisons to kill themselves.
Right.
So I treat them. I have ventilators. I have ICU. But then when I treat them, they don't go to psychiatrist. Then I was interested in psychiatry myself. So I am not a a qualified psychiatrist, but I read psychiatry and I was interested in psychiatry since the beginning. So I am practicing psychiatry. Even my hospital is licensed a psychiatric unit under Mental Health Act because of my experience.
Yes, yes.
And I have been treating my patients accordingly with medicines also and counseling also. And things I have learned in life, travel is my passion. I have been to about 70 countries. I have had skydiving, bungee jumping, everything.
That's amazing.
Even in spite of
skydiving and bungee jumping. That's
in spite of 2006, I got my aortic valve replaced, and 2010, I did skydiving, bungee jumping, music.
Wow.
Without any fear, because I knew I'm okay, I'm fit.
That's what comes from being a good doctor, because you know yourself as well as, you know, and the people you are treating.
Yeah, because you know it is safe. You know it is safe. You know the status of your heart, then you can do it.
Yes. So, sir, if we come to our topic, which is menopause and andropause, like for women, it is a very obvious thing. Women go through menopause and they have all these big health problems, which many women, they don't realize. They focus mostly on the symptoms that bother them, like hot flushes or vaginal dryness. And they kind of ignore the heart problems, bone disease, mental health issues, depression. And in andropause, do men also go through such problems which are not recognizable on the surface?
Well, Dr. Nilima, I just give you an example of a small flower, a bud. You see a rosebud. The sepals separate, the petals come, the flower blooms. Then after some time, the flower ages, the petals get wrinkled, the color changes, and the fruit forms, the seeds form, and the flower dies. Mm. That is the life.
Yeah.
Similarly, we humans have like 100 years of life. We start with small, young age. We grow up, adulthood, you know, peak of our life. We are blooming like a flower, and then gradually it goes off. It is a natural phenomena with men and women.
Mm.
So, because women earlier, they can produce children, and they have, periods, and they produce eggs, and after aging, it stops, and they have a clear demarcation.
Yes.
In men, there is no demarcation in producing children, because they produce sperms, they can have sexual activity till any age.
Yes.
In my own clinical practice, I have seen 80-year men having sexual satisfaction.
Yes.
I have not been able to talk to people beyond 80 about this.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe it is till the death.
Yeah.
So I would say that it's a gradual thing. Men, of course, start realizing this after the age of 30, 40, that the same sexual vigor or, you know, aggression in life or, you know, activity. There's so many things that gradually decrease. It is not only sexual.
Mm-hmm.
It is in general, because some people get more, some people get. Women also, not every woman gets postmenopausal symptoms.
No.
It is only few women who get it, and very few who need actual treatment or maybe hormone replacement. And similarly, men also, all the men have aging, all the men do feel changes in their body. I mean, their paunch comes out, their muscles or six packs or five packs, they don't remain the packs, and gradually the fat gets deposited. Similarly, they get osteopenia. Or
suitcases.
Yeah, because changes do occur. And over the years, it increases, it keeps increasing. So you have even mentally, people sometimes get depressed. Sometimes they get less sleep. Cognition, understanding, and then memory also changes. So these changes occur very gradually. But once these changes trouble a person, or if he knows that these changes can be reversed to some extent, or he can be helped, then of course we have options. We have so many things to do for him. So men actually do not consult physicians for andropause. It is our duty as physicians and doctors, or it is the duty of the woman that your audience is, that their husbands, because I think women take care of their husbands' health very well, and they are more sensitive than men.
Yes, because men don't like to ask care. For help. Men don't like to ask for help.
And if the women
women will know.
Women will know, and if the woman has knowledge that her husband can be helped under these circumstances if he has loss of libido.
Yes.
Libido is less desire.
Yes.
Because it's a technical word and many women would not know. Desire for sex has decreased. If he is not, the wife wants sex, like maybe once a week or once a month or twice, but the frequency, of course, decreases with age.
Mm-hmm.
But if the husband is not interested at all,
then
sometimes the husband tells the wife that he's busy or he's tired or he has no time or he has no inclination, his mood is not good. But if she realizes that her husband is not behaving that way as she wants, then it is possible that the husband could have andropause.
Mm.
And he should seek medical help. Andros is a Greek word.
Isn't it?
Andros means
men will have, like, if men discover that when they're masturbating, they have erectile dysfunction or the erection is not strong enough, also they may avoid having sex with their wives. And we know that, like, erectile dysfunction is a marker for heart disease. So I suppose menopausal woman may also recognize these symptoms in her husband or partner. So rather than feeling resentful, if she can encourage him to get a checkup, then we know that with at least, you know, cardiovascular disease can be reversed, isn't it?
Of course, erectile dysfunction, because of the vascular component, the blood vessels of the penis, they also get narrowed and the blood flow to the penis is less. This is visible in the form of erectile dysfunction.
Yes.
But the blood flow to the heart is decreasing, which is not visible to the man or the woman.
Yes.
That they are going to get it and then they get the attack or some problem. Even backache also, we say.
Really?
That backache also is a precursor of coronary artery disease or even erectile dysfunction. Because vascular component when the blood supply to certain organ falls, it falls all over, in the brain also, in the heart also, in his penis also, in his genitals also. So erectile dysfunction could be because of andropause. Andropause, we say, because of the hormone is less. Testosterone is the male hormone that pushes him, that makes him male, that gives him the desire to have sex and desire to, and he can perform well in sex. Yes. He gets good erection. And at the same time, the vascular component is different. It can be there without fall in testosterone.
Mm-hmm.
So if the nocturnal erection, like in the early morning, men get erection of the penis naturally because of the male hormone testosterone.
Yeah.
And if the erection is not there, the wife can know in the early morning, most of the men in their pajamas will get erection. And at younger age, it is very rigid and very common. But as the age increases, the nocturnal erections decrease just simply because of this. Is the first and clear-cut sign that testosterone level is falling.
Yes.
So at that stage, under medical supervision, safely we can prescribe testosterone replacement therapy wherever indicated.
Mm-hmm.
There are conditions where we will give, there are conditions where we will not give.
Yeah.
So, but it can be given and it can help. Yeah. Otherwise, the wife must know that because it is a gradual process, as I told, it is an aging process. Like the flower withers, the human body also withers with time.
Mm-hmm.
She should know that the same amount of desire and the same amount of sex performance is not expected of the husband when they got married and after 20 years of marriage or after 30 years or 40 years of marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So the men don't come with the manual how to operate the man. The woman doesn't have the manual for his husband, for her husband. She has to give extra stimulation to her husband to perform better.
Yeah.
One is love, encouragement. One is because When the testosterone level was high, the man would get erection and desire even without touching the genitals or even without kissing, without fondling, without foreplay. But after the age increases, the man need extra stimulation.
Yes.
So it can be in the form of cuddling. It can be in the form of wife taking the lead.
Yes.
The partner, the woman should take the lead so that the husband performs better. So this has to be taught to the woman that your husband with age would need extra stimulation. It would be not the same.
Yeah.
This is one thing that they should know.
So you talked a little bit about depression also earlier. And then we know that about 30% of women will go through depression as they go through menopause, de novo depressive changes. And men also, you said, as they go through andropause, they may also have depression. Besides this, around this time, both partners may have things like diabetes, heart disease, hypertension. Sometimes, you know, around this time, cancers also start to peak. So as a couple who is going through health challenges, how should each partner deal with the other person's health challenges? What is the best way for couples to work together on their health challenges?
Middle age naturally would lead to almost, whether it is menopause or andropause, both husband and wife and both the partners are going to get almost similar problems, like metabolic syndrome, we call it, when there is obesity, when there is insulin resistance, they can get diabetes, hypertension, at the same time, even depression, lack of sleep and all.
Yeah.
So at that time, they need to correct it by exercise, both of them.
Okay.
And many men increase their alcohol intake, and alcohol itself, or even women, alcohol itself leads to liver problems, and then increase in incidence of diabetes, decrease in hormones.
Yes.
Testosterone will decrease with the alcohol intake.
Alcohol stimulates liver and the SHBG. Circulating testosterone is decreased, yes.
And physical exercise helps produce testosterone. Even diet also matters, whether they are taking healthy diet or only fatty or carbohydrate diet, because there are certain foods which will help make more testosterone, like green leafy vegetables, fruits, pomegranates, some fatty fish, sesame, and this flax seeds, or walnuts, so beans, lemon. So some healthy diet can help produce testosterone, and people should follow good healthy diet.
Mm-hmm.
Along fresh green leafy vegetables. In India, we probably have the habit of fresh foods and fresh cooking.
Yeah.
But in many countries, people don't. We are very lucky because it is in our culture.
Yes.
We have to cook daily fresh food.
Yes.
But not in all countries. They don't cook fresh food. They cook for 1 week and then consume food.
That's
and even processed food is available off the shelf. You don't have to cook. It's already pre-cooked. So many things are lost there and it has harm. So exercise is very, very important. And mental health also is important, which should involve family, which should involve friends. Because as humans, as the society is developing, we are going apart and we are being self-centered, living in small flats or houses, not concerned about neighbors or friends or, you know, or office mates. That has deprived us of our social network and social well-being.
Yes.
It's a great thing. It's a very, very useful thing.
Yeah.
And we should again form community gatherings. Like I tell about myself, for the last about 40 years, we have 40 people. We have a morning walk club.
Okay.
From different walks of people, lawyers, businessmen, doctors, property dealers, different. And we all go in our cars to a particular university campus and we take walk. We can go to gym, we can do yoga together. Then we go at some of our place We have small den where we have tea together, maybe talk, share, enjoy. And we have a good 1.5 hour in the morning where we can have interaction.
Yes.
These kinds of gatherings, these kinds of things help to keep you fit, because of company, you definitely would enjoy the walk. You will enjoy your morning exercise.
Yes.
And alone, it is not possible. Yeah. And with partner, only two people, maybe it becomes boring with the same topic every time.
Yeah.
So women and men should have their own social circle.
Yes.
Where it's not only kitty party and going and eating and playing.
Yeah.
It should be the social work. I mean, the social gathering should include physical exercise.
Yes.
This should become a model for people.
Absolutely. So, when you talk about men and women and them using their social circles, many times, like I used to tell my patients that you may have different friend circles for different purposes. So you have girlfriend, you have some girlfriends that you go out, to exercise with. Maybe you have some girlfriends that you go out and you have just a conversation and you tell them, okay, you know, I'm going to talk about this. They're like counselors. Then you have some friends that you don't talk about. You only have work relationships with them. When men interact with each other about relationship issues, about maybe problems they have with their wives, what kind of help should they get? I mean, should they rely on their friends, or at what point should their friends actually tell them, look, hang on, you know, I'm not qualified to deal with this. You need to see a doctor.
Well, it depends. The friends can help and the friends can misguide also.
Yes.
Depend on their intellectual status, their knowledge. So he would be sincere, of course, but he may not be learned enough to tell the right thing.
Yes.
It is always better to consult a qualified person like a doctor.
So what age do you think that, you know, is there something like a routine health checkup that men should have? Like we tell women, you know, as they start to go into their 40s, they should get an annual checkup because, you know, irregular periods are there. They need like a pap smear every 3 years. They should get, you know, ultrasound done for screening for ovaries. They should get a breast examination done. In men, what sort of assessment should be done on a regular basis? And what are the, when should they start? 30s, 40s?
20s.
20s, wow.
20.
Tell me more, sir. Why 20s?
20 is because at the baseline data, you should have at 20.
India,
we have seen coronary deaths at 24.
Wow.
As young as 24. We Indians are prone to coronary disease.
Syndrome related or exercise related? Because I know... like,
No. Because of small coronary arteries, genetic predisposition. Right. Our country has suffered from malnutrition and starvation for maybe 500 years or 1,000 years.
Yes.
Maternal nutrition had been poor.
Yes.
Our kids were low birth weight.
Yes.
All through. So they had, height was small and they had small coronary arteries. It's why we get triple vessel disease instead of one vessel disease.
Yes.
So at the age of 20, we should have a lipid profile. We should have his basic tests done for liver, blood sugar and everything, height, weight.
Wow.
Because at our height, we have now the girls and boys are having tall. Now the children that we are producing are good. But earlier it was very bad because now the nutrition of mothers have improved.
Improved, yeah.
So I think that will help.
At
the age of 20, if they have a family history, if they have a family history of coronary artery disease and young deaths, then maybe at the age of 20, they can look after their blood pressure or their statins. Statins are not just to lower cholesterol level.
Right.
Statins, they stabilize the plaque in the coronary arteries and doesn't rupture to give heart attack. In now American guidelines and Indian guidelines, they say in all diabetics, we should give cholesterol lowering drug statin like atorvastatin or rosuvastatin, even if the cholesterol level is normal.
Why is that, sir?
Because to protect from heart attack.
Oh.
Diabetes and heart disease, they are part of the same coin.
Yes.
It is a metabolic disease. It is a cardiovascular and metabolic disease.
Yes.
So if we are giving statins to a case person of diabetes, even if his cholesterol is normal, his chances of dying of a sudden heart attack would decrease substantially.
So you said something about brain health also, I remember, when you were
yes.
talking about statins.
So let me
just... At the age of 20,
screen, if there is a problem, the doctor should advise statin to a person who is prone to get coronary artery disease. Otherwise, keep having investigations every 5 years. And at any stage, when there is a deviation, or if the person is not following a healthy lifestyle, the doctor can advise him to indulge in exercise or control his weight or control his alcohol intake, because alcoholism and even drugs, for that matter.
Smoking, yeah, smoking as well.
Yeah, and then nowadays, wherever needed, statins should be used.
Yeah. So you have, how many cases do you think you have on your record that if they had not taken statins, they would have died and they're still alive because of statins?
I have a family in who people died at the age of 42, all of them.
Really? Wow. Only the women are left.
Many, 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 many people, all men.
Wow.
And when the person comes in my contact long time back, I asked him to start statin in good dosage. And he's alive today also.
How old is he now, sir?
Must be 80-something.
Wow. So he outlived by almost double the age.
Because their family history was strong. Yes.
Yeah.
And I tell many of my patients that the only side effect of statins is longevity.
Is what?
Your friends, longevity.
Oh, longevity. Right.
Only side effect is this. Right. That your friends will go and you will stay on the crease. People will put garland on their pictures, but you will be standing there because you are taking statin. Statin is such a wonderful drug.
So what do you recommend for the, like, I know because my parents, my dad and mom, they both had diabetes and hypertension. Both of them were on statins. So some common side effects of statins is extreme tiredness, this kind of the arms, like muscle aches, and the black coloration on the skin.
No. Black coloration doesn't occur with this. No, it doesn't. The myalgias occur in some people. But not common. Some fatigue, etc., can be taken care by giving CoQ10.
Coenzyme Q10.
That helps. Right. So one can give CoQ10, like in a year, you can give for 1 or 2 months, like right. 15 days.
Right.
And you can also give a drug holiday of statins.
Okay.
Like after 2-3 months, stop for 10 days.
Right.
Again, after 2-3 months, stop for 10 days.
So they say, like, when you give statins, there may be some drug interaction. Suppose the man has got erectile dysfunction and you're giving them PDE5 inhibitors, then because
statins do not
lowering cholesterol, they can also have a inhibitory effect on other drugs.
Not exactly. Many people say that statins lower cholesterol, and cholesterol is also important to produce male hormone.
Yes.
Male hormone.
Yes.
But not really. It doesn't significantly reduce this. In fact, my personal opinion is that statins help in erectile dysfunction.
Right. Okay.
Because the vascular component of the even penile arteries will be better if you are on statins.
Right.
And if you are living, then you need everything else.
Yeah.
If you are dead without statins.
Yeah. I think nothing causes more depression to people, that knowing that, oh my God, the time is there, like the time is numbered. It was like, when you talked about the lifestyle factors and, you know, doctors advise patients a lot of the times, you know, do this, change this, stop smoking, stop alcohol, improve your exercise.
We in India very much need to emphasize on lifestyle.
Yeah, but why don't we encourage our
kids to play. We always encourage them to have good marks in academics, excel in this, excel in that. While in many, all over the world, people are there for the children to play and go out, and they encourage. Our country, we need to encourage our children to have physical activity. And the parents, if they are physically active, the same culture the children will adopt.
Yes.
Physical activity is a must, is a must.
So why do some people not engage with this advice? Because I have seen that some people are so depressed or upset with their life that they're like, "Arey, jab jeene ki ichha nahi hai, to lifestyle karke. When you are not interested in life, then lifestyle ka kya karna? Big deal." And they're kind of thinking, "What is the point of changing lifestyle?" And I try to tell them that, look, you know, a heart attack only kills a small number of people. The people who have to survive a heart attack have a really poor quality of life. So you know, if you think that you're just going to get a heart attack and die, you're sadly mistaken, because it doesn't always work like that. So for such people, you know, who are depressed or who don't see the joy in life, what, you know, how do you help them, you know, with your psychiatrist hat on? Because I'm sure, you know, because of these people who are committing suicide or attempting suicide, or they're overdosing on drugs, where you have to do a lot of counseling and help them to see, like reframe their perspective on life, you have to tell them something different. Just telling them go exercise or stop smoking alcohol may not be working, because their basic view of life is different.
Actually, the patient who has come to you is protected if the doctor knows his job.
Right.
Problem is those who don't come to you. The whole world, the whole country, the whole people sitting at their homes, having depression, but not seeking help. Having alcohol problems, but not seeking help. Or even nobody guiding them that this can be taken care of or this can be helped. If he comes to me, it is very easy. Of course, I do it always. All patients who come to me, whether they have survived a suicidal attempt or just diabetes, just hypertension, just bronchial asthma, I always look at their mental health and try to give them counseling on how to have healthy mind with healthy body.
Yeah.
And to have healthy mind, the first thing is love yourself.
Right.
I have to tell them, you are a piece of God in you.
Yeah.
If there is ocean and I take a drop of water from the ocean and put it on my palm, that drop was a ocean.
Yes.
Similarly, the soul in us, like we believe in Hindu mythology, our consciousness is the part of greater consciousness.
Yes.
You can call that greater consciousness God.
Yes.
So I tell them, you are a piece of God. Yes. In you.
Yes.
So you should be happy about yourself and you should love yourself. The body cover that you have, it is going to age, but you don't age. It's why you never feel that you are getting old.
Yeah.
Because you always feel, I was 4 years old, I was me. When I was in 10th class, I was me. When I was in medical school, I was me. I'm the same.
Yeah.
Because actually, I am the same. You are never going to die.
No.
You are going to transform into different things. So first of all, love yourself. Once you love yourself, and once you know that you have a very precious little thing in you, the part of God, then why are you feeling small or guilt or anything? I mean, all these things are very small.
Yeah.
Once you love yourself, and once you, like we were talking, gratitude,
yeah,
once you thank God, whenever you are feeling bad, if something very, very bad has happened to you, say, thank you, God.
Wow.
You will say, why should I thank God?
Yeah.
I've been robbed. There has been fire in my home.
Yeah.
I'm ruined. I say thank God. When you say thank God, you will think of 100 things that are still good. You are alive. That is the best thing.
Yes, yes.
This moment you are alive is the biggest thing in life.
Yes.
We should be grateful to God. Because you never know. You never know. There's a very thin line between life and death. So, number one, gratitude and thanks. Then, think of the present only.
Yes.
Don't think of past that is gone and future, just work, but leave to destiny and God. So there are, many things for counseling, but primarily as a doctor, all of us should be trained enough to whosoever comes to you is not only touched by or treated by medicines, he's also treated by some form of psychotherapy to have a healthy lifestyle. And healthy lifestyle cannot happen without healthy mind. In fact, first thing is healthy mind. If your mind is healthy, if you're peaceful, you will be able to act upon things. Yeah. And in that, people don't walk or people don't exercise because of lack of company also.
Yeah.
Company helps, like we talked earlier.
Yes, yes.
So one has to act a little fast. Like if the partner is there, the wife should make sure that the husband has friends with whom he can hang out and then go for exercise.
Because this
and
is
similarly, the whole family
that,
can.
Yeah, this is one of the mistakes that women make in the beginning of the relationship. They almost kind of isolate the guy. And then it becomes very difficult because many friendships are maintained over time. Constant contact with time. If you isolate the guy and don't allow him to maintain his friendships, then this basic social connection is lost. And it's very difficult to make friends when you become older.
You should give space in marriage or in live-in or whatever your howsoever you are living together. You should give freedom, little freedom to each other.
Mm.
So that they have their own individuality. They have their own, because each one has different individuality.
Yes.
And space has to be given.
Yes.
And you have to accept your partner as he or she is.
Yes.
Don't try to change people. We try to change people, then we become unhappy.
Yes.
Happiness is a lifestyle.
Yes.
Happiness is an attitude. Happiness is a style of living.
Yes.
If I want that I should be happy, nobody can make me unhappy.
Yeah, it's a choice.
Nothing can make me unhappy.
Yeah.
Even losses cannot make you unhappy. Disease cannot make me unhappy. I should accept the disease. I told you I had calcific aortic valve. It was stenosis. A medical rep gave me a stethoscope as a gift in 2002. I auscultated my heart and found aortic systolic murmur.
Oh my God.
I have something here. Then I did it with my own stetho, then got my echo done and kept monitoring. In 2006, I got an aortic valve. They said, do you want a metallic valve or bioprosthetic? I said, metallic, I will have to take anticoagulants. Then you will put me on many conditions. Don't take this, don't take this. This will, because anticoagulants, you have to take precautions, at least the older ones. Now new ones have come. So I got a bioprosthetic valve. I said it will last for 10, 15 years. Then I'll again get a valve, but at least 15 years I will enjoy free life.
Yes.
I'll be able to travel to any country, eat any kind of food and all. Then again, I got operated in 2019.
Wow.
Now, 2 years back. And again, I had no pain during my operation. Third day, I was walking with all those tubes in. Because mentally, I was prepared and thankful to God that you have given my body a problem.
Yes.
I am different from my body.
Yes.
You have given my body a problem. And this problem, you have given me money. You have given me science. You have given me a surgeon to do it. And let's enjoy it. I enjoyed my surgery. I thoroughly enjoyed my surgery. That was a vacation I spent at that multi-speciality hospital.
Wonderful. That is just so amazing. It is so inspiring to hear that story.
In 2017, I got a stent done.
You know, I get this.
I got a stent in 2017 And 2018, I did skydiving again in
wow.
Fiji.
That's amazing.
Because I knew my heart is now, I have a stent. Why can't I do it?
Yeah.
No, my heart is healthier, so I can do it.
Wow.
Once it is going to get, now that I have a new valve, at least for 7-8 years, still it gets, degeneration and I can again enjoy.
I think that you have a very, very long, long life. Your patients and people like me and my friends and
life should be beautiful. It should be blessed. It should be nice. Long or small doesn't matter.
Yes.
Contentment. If I am contented, I am prepared to go. If I am not contented, you will die unhappy. What is the fun? What's the fun? You should have contentment. I am blessed. I am contented. If I live more years, I will get more experience or more things. And even if there's a bad experience, even if so-called bad experience, you take it as an experience. That is to be taught to the patients also.
Yes.
That life is not a straight line. If some upheavals come in your family life, with husband and wife, they should take it as an experience that you have become enriched with.
Together.
Without that experience, you would have been flat, not knowing much. Just pleasures, no fun. Just a silver spoon in your mouth, no fun. You should have ups and downs so that you become enriched and you become have a varied experience. But even negative things you should enjoy.
Yes.
That they have come across you for you to, you should test yourself with that.
Yeah, because many people, especially women, I've seen as they go through menopause or even men also, they become bitter and angry and bitchy. They become this angry old women, grumpy old women, grumpy old men, bitching constantly, complaining, getting angry. And now we know that more and more research is coming out about the ill effects of anger. And anger is directly correlated with poor heart, cardiac disease, heart attacks, early deaths, dementia, vascular disease. So, it doesn't help either men or women to be angry. It is not like a badge of honor to be an angry old man or an angry old woman.
Actually, we have a deficiency in our schooling and education system. Nobody teaches you to have peace, happiness, how to have peace and happiness.
Yeah.
Not parents, as parents, they don't know, so they don't teach their children. And in schools also, they don't teach how to have good, healthy physical and mental health, spiritual health. So if a person who is angry, bitchy or tense, or if he comes in a contact with a person who knows what to tell him and he talks with him, I think his nature can change. And then he can also start enjoying life. Everybody deserves to have a happy life.
Yeah.
You are born to have a happy life.
Yeah.
But we spoil our happiness ourselves because of lack of knowledge how to live happily. Happiness is not outside. This is the basic thing.
Yeah.
It is not money. If a patient came to me day before, he was a rickshaw puller.
Right.
And like usual, we take history, cough, cold, this, that. And in the end, I just asked, do you have any problem or are you upset or anything? He said, no, doctor, I have no problem. I have my own rickshaw. I don't have to pay rent for that. I have my own kacha house, mud house, which I have purchased in 25,000. And it's my own house. I have a good, obedient wife. I have two children who go to school. One is in fourth class, one in his second class. And they are very healthy and good. So I am very, very happy. Contentment.
Yes.
He was happy because he doesn't have to pay rent for his rickshaw.
Yes.
And even if a rich, billionaire commits suicide, we see. Because they're not happy.
Yeah. Money
contentment. Contentment. So his happiness is derived from small little things.
Yes.
If he wants to be happy, he can be happy with small things also.
Yes.
It is not necessary that I don't have a big bungalow, I don't have a car, so I have a reason to be unhappy. Comparison is not needed. You are yourself part of God. You are complete in yourself.
Yes.
And you can be happy with yourself. Happiness you should not lose at all.
No.
That needs to be taught to people.
Yes.
And I was also touching about this obstructive sleep apnea also.
Yes.
There is one point that comes with andropause. And if there is obstructive sleep apnea or patient has excessive drowsiness, then also they should seek medical help.
Yes.
The wife should know.
Snoring, yes.
And
if they're not sleeping properly, not sleeping, a lot of snoring is going on.
Men are more prone to death.
Right.
So the wives must take care of their men in the form of good health checkup and regular consultation with a doctor, then have good lifestyle, healthy food at home. Because many people, you know, they eat so much of non-vegetarian food with alcohol and smoke.
Yes.
And they kill themselves because of these things.
Yes.
And with love and affection, this can be taken care of by the spouse.
Yes.
If one is indulging in this. But it can only be with love and care. Those wives or husbands, if they nag with the partner, it aggravates.
Yes.
It's only with encouragement that you are wise and good. And you should be able to do it.
Yes.
And then things can be easy and they can have medical help also.
Yes. So what are the tips for women and men as they go through menopause, andropause? What final tips would you like to give them regarding the health, growing old, aging?
Nobody dies suddenly except motor vehicle accident. There is something brewing inside which kills. The first thing is health checkup, so that you can have timely action to control diseases like heart attack, brain stroke, kidney failures because of hypertension, diabetes, cancer prevention, vaccinations, mental peace. Because if you don't have mental peace, you are frustrated, you fight at home, and then you fight in your office, or you are driving in a frustrated mood. You can meet an accident because of, I mean, this plays a lot of role.
Yes.
So one should be able to have a health checkup and adopt good healthy lifestyle, take regular medicines, take regular exercise, healthy good food, with of course exceptions to have fun or experiment with other enjoyable foods. I mean, it's not necessary that you are too much of discipline. No. I always advocate it should be fairly balanced thing, so that you enjoy life as you want. At the same time, not harm, because enjoyment is not only in alcohol or not only in things. Smoking is, of course, dangerous. Alcohol in moderation is okay. But alcohol, who would be able to control alcohol intake is not known.
Yeah.
Some people,
when moderation becomes severe,
if it increases, if you drink more than what you intended, and if you feel guilty the next day, don't drink at all.
Don't drink. Yeah.
Don't even drink, because then you will not stop at one drink or two drinks.
Yeah.
And if you are happy, you are always drunk like me. I don't drink. I'm always drunk. I say, you drink now, I am drunk 24 hours.
You keep yourself very fit and mentally also sharp, and you keep yourself happy.
I think it is probably God's blessing also. I don't think it is purely, with effort. Maybe it comes with age, maybe I was also, when I was young, I was aggressive. My testosterone level was more. Then you would do this, that. Everything comes down with age. It's why with age, people become spiritual. And we have four stages according to Hindu mythology, young, brahmacharya, and then marital life. Then ultimately, you just go to, you know, spiritual side of the life.
Yes.
It is again hormonal.
Yes. It is also a case like in Hindu tradition, like when the son and the daughter-in-law are there, or the older lady used to stay back to look after the kids, and the husband used to go vanprasthashram. He used to go off to do, you know, his spiritual studies or whatever, so that there is no dependence of the children on the father to constantly take advice. They get a chance to grow up. And then when the father becomes old and they come back, then they go into sannyas ashram. By that time, the elderly lady, the grandmother, is looking after grandkids, etc. But I used to always wonder that they didn't make any provision for the older couple to maintain their couple relationship. There's like this funny concept of that the husband and wife should separate after a certain age.
That is not desirable.
Marital life.
Yes, in fact, the society or our family system should have that the old people. I have seen many old people in great love, and even they have active sexual life. Very old people. And sometimes after the heart attack, or after, even if the patient is 80-year-old, he would say, "Doctor, now can I have sex?" And I feel good that he is alive to that thing.
Yes.
And his wife is also equally good as a partner. Okay. Yes. I salute them from my heart, even if I don't say that it's very good.
Yes.
It is. It's a basic thing like food and water and air.
Yes.
And if they can have it, it is the best thing. But then they should know how they can help each other.
Yeah. This is an amazing, amazing conversation.
And of course, there are medicines. Then the doctor would decide when to give testosterone and when not to give, because there is a prostate cancer or breast cancer. Yeah. We avoid that. And this testosterone hormone may not cause prostate cancer. The doctor would test before giving. But when we give, it is mostly safe and it is very good. It gives good effect. And we give for a small time, like about 6 months or so. We don't give lifelong. We cannot convert totally the aging process.
Yeah.
The body has to wither with time.
Yeah.
We don't have at the present in our science to reverse aging or to halt aging altogether. It would be wonderful if you can stop the age at 30 years and you stay 30 year like body throughout.
Yeah. So some men, and I speak from, I just representing some of the men I see in my clinic with erectile dysfunction, maybe they're diabetic or they're hypertensive. And they are concerned about taking medicines like PDE5, you know, sildenafil or tadalafil. And they go on the internet and they read the side effects and have these 100 questions, you know, should I take it? Shall I take it? What shall I do? So what tips can you give about when men decide to take and the doctors prescribe? You know, a lot of doctors are afraid of prescribing also because they are not sure of assessing the patient correctly. So some tips for doctors for prescribing PDE5 inhibitors, and some tips for patients about what to not fear about PDE5 inhibitors. So can you talk a little bit about PDE5
inhibitors? They are absolutely beautiful molecule that has been invented. It helps a lot in erectile dysfunction for men, and it should be used. The only thing is that the dose of the medication is individualized.
Yeah.
Some people tolerate a smaller dose, some people tolerate full dose. Initially, to test, one should give smaller dose and then gradually increase. Those who are on nitrates, they absolutely contraindication that you cannot give people PDE5 inhibitors if they are on nitrate, because that will lead to fall in PDE.
Yeah.
If they are on vasodilators, then we can't give.
Hmm.
So that precaution one has to take. Otherwise, there is no, I mean, contraindication. Patients on other drugs can take. And you should give smaller doses, like 25 milligram of sildenafil, then 50 or 100 later. And older people tolerate smaller dosages.
Yes.
Small headache should be expected, and this should be, you know, tolerated by the patient to have the benefit of a good sex with PDE5 inhibitor. Mm. So one can tell you can have a small headache, but then you can have good erection and good sex. So maybe you can take paracetamol, Tylenol to kill pain if you have. So it should be used frequently. And there are now newer drugs like sildenafil. Now you have tadalafil, the long active, then eudenafil. Then you have some very max, what is the brand?
Vardenafil and Navanafil, the newer one.
Vardenafil.
Yes.
That is Vardenafil.
Yes.
They're also good. So one can try the different molecule also in a patient.
So because
or the patient can try different things.
Different molecules, because each of them has a different duration of action, and each of them...
Accordingly, you have to advise which time they should take.
Yes.
And patient's lifestyle. Some patients don't want that I should be able to take 1.5 hour before sex or 2 hours before sex.
Yes.
Then you can give tadalafil that anytime they can have sex.
So what is your opinion about daily dosing? Because I noticed that you recommend...
To psychogenic patients and to patients who have some inhibition or psychological factors, we give 5 milligram tadalafil every day in the morning.
Okay.
It is safe. I use it quite often. And it helps them. And then you can, once the things are done and he's okay mentally and he's forgotten his problem, then you can just wave off or stop it.
I was reading some research papers recently about the benefits of PDE5 inhibitors in metabolic syndrome, particularly in diabetics, because of its effect on the blood vessel wall. So what is your experience or your... Knowledge, and it is good.
It is good in pulmonary hypertension also. We prescribe it for pulmonary arterial hypertension.
Yes, yes.
And but regularly we don't use it. But in diabetics and in andropause and in metabolic syndrome, I have given testosterone.
Right.
Or I have given gonadotrophins.
Okay.
If patient wants good sperms also, he has to produce children also, then we don't give testosterone, because testosterone would suppress his spermatogenesis.
Yeah.
The sperms will not be of good quality.
Yeah.
In that case, we use HCG, subcutaneous injections, to promote his LH, luteinizing hormone, that will in later produce more testosterone from testes.
I think also.
So we can use.
Yes.
And mind also plays a lot of role. Hypothalamus and pituitary, that is the axis.
Yes.
So giving positive psychotherapy, telling them that with each day you will find yourself, this is like a hypnotic suggestion.
Yes.
That
every day.
It is going to help you. His mind will produce more GNRH than. Releasing factors, gonadotrophin releasing factors, then that further lead to LH and FSH and testosterone. So positive thing, because this helps.
I think
it's why the doctor faith in the patient helps.
Yeah, and when you prescribe it, I think it is important to include the wife also in it, because we know that with PDE5 inhibitors, they don't work on their own. They still need stimulation, like you mentioned earlier.
They will need stimulation.
So without stimulation, it doesn't work.
It is zero. Without stimulation, it is zero. And you need desire also. You need the partner's role also. Unfortunately, India, people don't bring their wives, or wives are not interested to come. And we have to just give them psychotherapy. And sometimes, of course, we stop. We ask them not to have sex and only take treatment. So that once they have erections and the desire is built up, and they have more desire, then they become confident that now it's okay.
Yes.
But once the problem is more, and if you think it cannot be solved, then we ask the patient that you must bring your wife along so that we tell her that you are a good, potent man.
Yes.
You have no deficiency. If I tell as a doctor to the wife, you are on a safer side.
Yes.
Because the doctor is telling that your husband is good and potent.
Yes. I think once the wives who are listening to this talk, they realize the importance that if a man is not getting an erection, it's not because he's not attracted to her. Because women are such that they are consumed with guilt, self-recrimination. They automatically assume if the husband is not getting an erection, it is their fault or he's having an affair. So they should stop thinking in that manner and actually see the erectile dysfunction or loss of desire as a warning bell to actually include themselves in his management and treatment and maybe accompany him to the physician. This is so much easier when both of them are there.
Men and women both should understand that this is love, affection, and care for each other.
Yes.
First of all. And understanding each other. No suspicion. So if the woman is understanding and having love for his husband and the husband is having love for his partner, both should help each other.
Yes.
That is the basic first thing. Then, of course, once they go to the doctor also tells them the physiology and anatomy of sex and then explains how things work, how sex works. And of course, in the middle age or in the later ages, the man, as I told, needs extra stimulation. Then the wife should go ahead and help her husband. And it should be told to the wife that our mouth contains more bacteria than the genitals.
Yes.
And for oral stimulation also, there is no harm. It is recommended.
Yes.
Because in our culture, in Indian culture, it is being looked down upon.
Yes.
That it's a filthy thing. It's a filthy place.
Yes.
So this has to be cleared.
Yes. Genital sex, everything about sex.
Similarly, the husband has to be told about stimulating the wife with tongue or lips.
Yes.
That needs, in our country at least, it needs. And they should not depend upon the porno films and the blue films that they watch, which are exaggerating things.
Yes.
That also harms. That the wife thinks that in the porno I have seen men perform like this, my husband is nothing.
It's like watching Singham and expecting your local police constable to suddenly start behaving like that.
this needs to be told. And I think this thing should be in the curriculum of the schools and colleges, that they should have a thorough, fair knowledge of sex, which is not there. I mean, time should come that it is part of our saints wrote Kama Sutra, that big granth at that time, with so many sex positions and types of kisses and types of hugs and types of everything. And we just stopped somewhere. It should have been percolated down to the society so that our children are educated about sex.
Yes.
Then they don't have to indulge in wrong things and wrong practices.
Yeah. And guilt. Big guilt.
Guilt.
Mm-hmm.
Many, many people have guilt. Masturbation guilt is tremendous with people.
Yes. So can you talk a little bit about masturbation for both men and women?
Sex is in the brain.
Hmm.
Between the two ears, not between the two legs.
Yes.
Number one.
Yes.
It starts from here.
Yes.
And your vagina or your penis doesn't have eyes.
No.
So whether you are having sexual stimulation with hand, with a vibrator, or with a ring, or with anything, is not known to your penis, it is known to your brain.
Yes.
So if your brain thinks it is bad, then it becomes bad. If your brain thinks it is not bad, it is not bad. That is the thing. How can it be bad? I mean, the penis doesn't know whether it is going into the vagina or it is going elsewhere.
Yes.
So if it is in the hands, then of course the masturbation also should be taught to the people so that they do it when they are free. They don't do it hurriedly to just have orgasm or discharge and to get rid of the semen.
Yes.
They should be able to enjoy it slowly and gradually, because that conditioning sometimes can harm later.
Yeah, because they get what they practice.
Some men have problem because they get conditioned with masturbation, with the speed of the movement of the penis, and then that speed doesn't come with the natural intercourse.
Yeah.
Or their physical health, the body, their lungs and their heart does not allow that much of action, physical action. So then that mismatch leads to failure in sexual intercourse.
Yeah. Or,
so that can be taken care of if the masturbation from the very beginning was trained to be slow and enjoyable, and once they had sufficient time with them.
Yeah.
Should not be a quickie, one or two minute job.
Yeah.
That should be taught to the children. And it is 101% safe. That should be taught to the girls and boys, that it is safe. You don't have to risk pregnancy. If the girl wants a sex with herself, she can masturbate, she can enjoy, and she doesn't risk getting pregnant with a boyfriend.
Yes. Same thing
and
for men.
When she has opportunity, then she can have sex.
Yeah. Same thing for men as well. They're talking about Dutt syndrome, about the guilt associated with ejaculation, and many cultures and religions, they frown upon ejaculation, which is happening without reproduction.
Oh, yeah. Ejaculation has to occur. It has to be told whether it is nocturnal ejaculation, which will occur if you don't put it out. And there is no, it's a misnomer that your semen will get stored and you will have strength. It is absolutely wrong.
Yes.
There is no place for storage. This has to be told to everyone that there is no storage kind of thing. And you don't become strong. Even Olympic champions are married and they have sex, they masturbate and they have every active life. They are not weak. That thing that brahmacharya is life, or it gives strength, and if you are celibate, you have more physical strength. It is wrong.
Yeah.
In fact, celibacy has no role. It can, if you are feeling guilty in not having sex or masturbating, you might be harming yourself more. And there is no limit to how much time one should have sex. It is the younger age group, it is more. As the age advances, it decreases. It is natural.
Exactly.
And for partners also, one partner want more sex, the other partners want less sex. They should match each other either with the form of sex or with the form of masturbation.
Yes.
If you not want to have sex, the wife can masturbate the man, or the man can masturbate the woman. Yes. And at least they can, you know, match each other's desire or the desire of frequency.
Yes.
And it's a common problem with men in India that their wives are not interested in sex.
Yes.
And that is a big problem, that they think, this is my fast, this is my religion, this is my bad day, this is my this day. And the men
feel deprived.
Yeah. And in that case, either the men should have masturbation or the wife should be taught that at least once a week, which is the normal frequency all over the globe at this age. Like, I'm giving just a rough example. So they can have some spare time for this, so that the need of each other is fulfilled.
Yes. Because otherwise they give up intimacy, closeness, connection also. In the name of giving up sex, they give up everything that is associated with being a couple.
And then extramarital affairs do happen because of this.
Yes.
Do happen.
Sir, it was a wonderful conversation. We covered so many different topics. Any last thoughts? Any thing you'd like to comment on?
I will only tell your viewers that you are born to enjoy life.
Yes.
so enjoy life. There should be nothing that should bar you from enjoying life. And take care of your body, because your body is going to take you places.
Yes.
Your body, through your this body, you are going to achieve many things. If you help, if you want to help someone, only through this body you will be able to help. So we take care of our car, we will put this oil, we will put this gas, but this body also we should take care, we should put in this and not that. We should service our body with the things. The body is more precious than our car.
Yes.
So we should look after our body the way we look after our car, that we should eat, put in good food, or make it walk. It needs walk. The manual of our bodies, there should be a manual how to maintain your body that has been given to you, because yes, you can't buy another body.
You can't replace it.
So think of that. Think in those terms that you have a body which has a manual, and according to the manual, you maintain your body well,
yes,
as long as it's possible.
Yes.
And keep your mind blissful.
Yes.
And nobody should be able to take away your happiness. No one.
Wonderful.
You should not allow anyone to take your happiness away.
Absolutely.
And it is, if you don't allow, nobody can take away your happiness.
Yes. Thank you.
It is my choice.
Thank you.
How would I react to you? If the husband has said something wrong to the wife, it is the wife's choice whether she fights back or she forgives him.
Yes.
He condones him. She smiles away only, that he's not wise to deal with the spouse, and I forgive him. But I am happy. No problem. I will tell him later on sometimes.
So you are going to sing a song.
Oh. Sure. I used to sing in my school days, though I don't drink, but this is on that, that let me live freely. I have a glass of wine. Let me drink today without any fear. And it tells the lyrics that you are beautiful, and you more beautiful, your thoughts and everything. Life is beautiful. So I just hum some lines. Hemant Kumar. ये नयन डरे डरे ये जाम भरे भरे जरा पीने दो कल की किसको खबर एक रात हो के निडर मुझे जीने दो
Amazing.
रात हसी ये चांद हसी और सबसे हसी मेरा दिलबर रात हसी ये चांद हसी उन सबसे हसी मेरे दिलबर और तुझसे हंसी तेरा प्यार ऊ जाने ना ये नयन डरे डरे ये जाम भरे भरे मुझे पीने दो प्यार में है जीवन की खुशी देती है खुशी कई गम भी प्यार में है जीवन की खुशी देती है खुशी कई गम भी मैं मान भी लूं कभी हार तू माने ना ये नयन डरे डरे ये जाम भरे भरे जरा पीने दो, कल की किसको खबर, एक रात हो के निडर, मुझे जीने दो। Thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful, amazing. Thank you so much. That was absolutely amazing. So touching and moving and
so let me live freely.
Beautiful. Very nice. So anybody
I
wants
just
to get
appeal
in
to all
you?
Those who will listen to the audio, live
yes.
freely, live
yes.
happily,
yes.
and seek help, have preventive health checkups.
So if they want to get in touch with you, so we'll share your email address and phone number, please.
My email would be khetarpaul@gmail.com. Khetarpaul, I spell as khetarpaul@gmail.com. And my phone of the reception through whom I can be contacted is +91 98 968 333 00.
Great. I'll add this in the comment section so that if people need to get in touch with you, it will be there in the comments for them to see.
I must thank you, Dr. Neelima, for this opportunity
you.
That you gave to me to address to your viewers and to talk to you. I am blessed. I am happy. And I'm thankful to God also for this opportunity that destiny just made us together to have a talk like this.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank
we
you
were
so
supposed
much.
To meet probably.
Yes, yes.
Thank
your
you.
Blessings for everybody. Thank you so much. Okay. Good night, everyone.
Good night.